Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to talk about the intestines, both the small and the large intestine. So we'll be comparing the structures of the small and the large intestine and go through some of the big picture, high yield concepts with these areas, such as the basics regarding neurovascular supply. So let's start with the small intestine, occasionally referred to as the small bowel, if only you were talking about the jejunum and the ileum. From proximal to distal, the small intestine is divided into three parts. The most proximal part and shortest is the duodenum, and we are going to discuss the duodenum in a later session where we will discuss with the very closely associated pancreas, which would be located right about here. Intermediate is going to be the jejunum, which is located mostly within that left upper quadrant, but as you can see, will certainly extend into some of the other quadrants. And the most distal and the longest portion is going to be the ileum, which will transition into the cecum at the ileocecal junction. The small intestine of the jejunum and ileum is very dominant, and it's very dominantly present within the abdominal cavity. It's very hard to miss. So dominant, it's often referred to as the mesentery. That root of the mesentery is going to attach to the posterior abdominal wall, and it will allow branches from the retroperitoneal aorta to actually reach the intestine, so it'll travel through the mesentery. Now, if you open the jejunum and ileum to view the mucosa like we've done here, you will see fairly prominent circular folds, particularly in the proximal portions of the jejunum. You will not have circular folds associated with the distalmost or the terminal portion of the ileum. The circular folds are complete, meaning it will form a complete circle within, unlike what we see with the semilunar folds of the large intestine. And these folds will serve to increase the surface area of the small intestine. That's particularly important in terms of absorption, which is an important role of the small intestine. Now, when you are viewing externally or macroscopically, it is very difficult to differentiate the jejunum from the ileum. In fact, you can't really do that. So if we were to ask you to differentiate between the two, we would have to ask you something well within the left upper quadrant, making that which one, the jejunum or the ileum? Yes, the jejunum is going to be in the left upper quadrant. And if we were talking about the right lower quadrant, that would be the ileum. Again, we are not talking about the duodenum quite yet as we move towards vasculature, which when we're talking duodenum will be unique as the duodenum is derived from both the foregut and the midgut. But the jejunum and the ileum are all midgut, so it follows the rules of having branches from the superior mesenteric artery or the SMA, specifically numerous jejunal and ileal branches that will supply the small intestine. This area will be drained by tributaries of the superior mesenteric vein, or the SMV, which is part of the hepatic portal system. Now, moving on to everyone's favorite, innervation. And the gastrointestinal tract is one of the more complex areas in terms of innervation. In fact, it has its own not-so-little nervous system, referred to as the enteric nervous system, or the ENS. And of course, it will also have autonomic supply as well. The enteric nervous system is often described as its own system or part of the larger autonomic nervous system, which I'm a bit more partial to, but is certainly unique in terms of location. The ENS is a complex series of nerve fibers and ganglia embedded in the walls of the viscera of the GI tract, and there are two systems of plexuses. Now, the Meissner, or the submucosal plexus, is going to be composed of a ganglionic nerve plexus within, or kind of associated with, the submucosa. Whereas Arbach's, or the myenteric plexus, which you can see right kind of here in this region, is located between the longitudinal and circular smooth muscle layers. So these differ mainly in terms of their location. Collectively, these plexuses are concerned with propulsion of contents through synchronized contractions, as well as mucosal functions. So very similar to what we will see in terms of the sympathetic and parasympathetic functions, and will be modulated by the autonomic nervous system. I believe you will have a whole lecture on the ENS, so this is just a small preview. The primary autonomic innervation is derived from the superior mesenteric plexus, which is an autonomic plexus that has both sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers. The sympathetic fibers are derived from those greater and lesser splanchnic nerves that we talked about way back in the posterior mediastinum session. And these will synapse in the celiac or superior mesenteric ganglia. So you can see some of that here and around here. So very closely associated to where those arteries branch off of the abdominal aorta. That's where those ganglia will be located. And as sympathetics often do, they'll play an important role in terms of vasoconstriction and will be inhibitory to smooth muscle. Now, when we're talking small intestine, for the most part, we are talking midgut. So we know that the parasympathetic source should be the vagus nerve, and it is. So that cranial nerve 10, I apologize if you heard my dog barking in the background. Now, remember, parasympathetics are important in resting and digesting. So it will play a role in initiating contraction of the smooth muscle of the gut tube and will be secretomotor to mucosa. Now, we reviewed the order of the large intestine in a previous video, but to make sure we are on the same page, let's go through it one more time. Let me clear my throat so we can do that. Okay, that ileum is going to transition into the cecum at the ileocecal junction. The ileum is the most proximal portion and often one of the largest in caliber. It will have the vermiform appendix attached to it. It will continue as the ascending colon, which will take an abrupt change in direction at the right colic or hepatic flexure. And it will continue to run transversely as the transverse colon, taking another sharp or abrupt change or turn at the left colic or splenic flexure. This will continue as the descending colon. And then there will be a few kind of turns which will indicate that you are in the sigmoid colon. And then the large intestine will begin to straighten out again, and that will be the rectum, which will transition into the anal canal at the pelvic diaphragm. Now recall that the large intestine is derived from both the midgut and the hindgut. That point of transition is about 2/3 of the way on the transverse colon. So anything from here on would be midgut, and from here further would be hindgut, or here distal, I guess, would be a more appropriate term. The intraperitoneal portions of the colon will have specific mesentery, such as the transverse mesocolon, as well as the mesoappendix, and the sigmoid colon, recall, is intraperitoneal, so it will have a sigmoid mesocolon. There are four structures that are unique to the large intestine that we want you to be familiar with. The first are going to be the tiny coli, or the tiny coli. You'll hear it all kinds of different ways. You'll see it spelled all different kinds of ways. This is missing an A in terms of its appropriate spelling. These are going to include three bands of muscles. You can only really see one here. They're forming the outer layer of the muscularis, and these are going to send small deviations kind of off to the sides that are going to form circumferential bands around the large intestine at fairly regular intervals. And what that will lead to is the creation of these very obvious hostra or hostrations or sacculations, which will appear as these kind of like puckering out of the large intestine throughout almost its entire length. And these will represent sites where the mucosa and submucosa of the colonic wall is infiltrated, and this will be viewable as semilunar folds if you are looking internally. The semilunar folds do not form complete rings like we saw with the circular folds of the small intestine. And lastly, we are going to have what's referred to as omental or epiploic appendages kind of throughout the span, but not in every single portion of the large intestine. These are going to be attached to the external surface of many parts, and these are fat-filled outpouchings of the peritoneum. So those are those epiploic or omental appendages. Now, in terms of arterial supply, it will be really helpful to keep in mind in what part of the large intestine is derived from the midgut. Those are going to be supplied by branches of the SMA, and which parts are derived from the hindgut, which will be supplied by branches of the inferior mesenteric artery. So let's go over some of the SMA branches or the midgut derivatives first. You'll have the ileocolic, which should have an O here. I apologize for the misspelling. The ileocolic is one of the largest in caliber and will dominantly supply the cecum, but it will send a branch or two to the ileum. You can see a little bit of that kind of heading off this way in this image. It will also give off the appendicular artery, which will supply, as its name would suggest, the appendix. The right colic is going to supply the ascending colon, whereas the middle colic is going to supply the transverse colon. In terms of the hindgut derivatives, these are going to be supplied by the inferior mesenteric artery and include the left colic, which we can see, where do we have that here? Yeah, you can see it's one of the larger ones in terms of caliber. The left colic is going to supply the descending colon and a little bit of the transverse colon, because recall that distal one-third is supplied by the inferior mesenteric. You will have a few sigmoid arteries, so you typically have more than one, sometimes two to three. Those are going to supply the sigmoid colon. And lastly, what I often looks to me like a continuation of the inferior mesenteric artery is going to be the superior rectal artery, which will supply the superior portions of the rectum. The vascular supply of the rectum is actually quite complex when you add in the more inferior portions of the rectum, and we will talk about that in a bit more detail in the pelvic anatomy sessions. Now, almost all of those branches that we just discussed will help to form the marginal artery, which I'm just going to kind of outline the basic placement of that, and it will extend obviously over into the left portion of the body as well. The marginal artery is an anastomotic artery that runs along the inferior or medial borders of the large intestine, and it's going to send short arteries to the actual viscera to supply. The fact that anastomoses are prevalent here is important in cases of occlusion of an artery or a branch. There will likely be some form of blood supply that can get to the area based on the fact that the marginal artery is running throughout almost the entire length. In terms of venous drainage, this will include tributaries of the superior and the inferior mesenteric veins, which are both part of the hepatic portal venous system. Last but not least is the innervation of the large intestine, which is not tremendously different from the small intestine, as you can see here in terms of the functions, very similar to what we talked about with the small intestine. The large intestine certainly has the enteric nervous system, as described with the small intestine as well. The sympathetics, when we're talking overall autonomics, will come from a multitude of sources, including the sympathetics from that superior mesenteric nerve plexus. Recall that nerve plexus had both parasympathetics and sympathetics, but it will have those specific fibers will play a role in terms of innervating the large intestine. Sorry, this should say large right here. So that is going to play a role in terms of the sympathetics, but we'll also have, importantly, the lumbar splanchnic nerves, which are going to innervate the more distal portions of the large intestine. Again, understanding which parts are derived from the midgut, so the proximal most portions to the about two-thirds of the way down on the transverse colon, will have its spare sympathetic supply from the vagus nerve. So vagus nerve, think midgut as well as foregut. And then the hindgut is going to have its parasympathetic supply derived from the pelvic splanchnic nerves via the inferior hypogastric plexus. So remember, those pelvic splanchnic nerves are the sacral portion of the parasympathetics from S2 through S4. So we have finally made our way to the summary slide, which I really worked to kind of pull out those high yield concepts, but please don't ignore the context we provided throughout the slides or the written descriptions. Please take your time to review and reach out if you have any questions. Thank you for your time and attention, and have a great rest of your day.